Please forgive someone like me. Goodbye.
The day after giving birth, what was next to my pillow was a suicide note from my husband. The shock was too much for me postpartum, and my mind went blank. Later, my husband's shoes were found at the edge of the cliff. After that, I was just barely getting by, living with my daughter, Alice, and before I knew it, 5 years had passed. I found solace in the growing, radiant smile of Alice. However, when I attended my friend's wedding, something shocking happened. Surprisingly, standing next to the bride was my husband. Dressed in a tuxedo, he had the same smile as before, standing there, supposedly having thrown himself into the sea. Why was he here? From there, I came to learn an unexpected truth, and as a result, his life took a downward turn. 5 years ago, at 35, I was working as a nail technician with regular clients. Dreaming of owning my own shop someday, I was working hard while saving up. Concerned about me being so focused on work and without a boyfriend, my best friend, Sarah, invited me to a mixer.
Emily, it's great that you're dedicated to your work, but you haven't given up on marriage or having kids, right? If so, you've got to seek out some encounters.
Encouraged by words from Sarah, a friend from high school who I've had a complicated relationship with, I decided to join, thinking it might be good for a change. And so, my life took a significant turn. At the mixer, I had an unexpectedly good encounter. We hit it off as if we'd known each other forever, and soon started dating. His name was Michael Thompson, a 38-year-old businessman. Both of us being in our late 30s, we were dating with the intention of getting married. But within 6 months, it found out I was pregnant. Michael, I think I'm pregnant.
What? Really?
The moment I told him, I thought I saw a startled look on his face, but he quickly smiled and hugged me. We decided to have the wedding after the baby was born and things settled down. And before that, we talked about getting legally married and starting to live together. However, during the move, my morning sickness worsened, and there were days I couldn't get out of bed.
We should get married sooner, so just sign the marriage application, and I'll submit it to the clerk's office.
I wanted to go together, sorry.
Don't worry, just dress for the baby.
I was always enveloped in his kindness. Yet, there was one concern. It was about my parents. Living in the countryside and concerned about social appearances due to their jobs, they had been pressing me about marriage whenever they saw me. I can't stand that, and I had stopped contacting them for a while. But when we announced the shotgun wedding, I'm expecting some disapproving looks from them again. As expected, when I contacted them, my father yelled, "It's shameful, don't come back home." Though I anticipated it, such a situation still brought me down, compounded by morning sickness, making every day gloomy. I gradually started missing work, spending most of my days in bed, unable to handle household chores, and settling for the bare minimum when it came to meals. I'm sorry, I couldn't do anything today either.
Test again.
As days went by, Michael, who was supposed to be kind, began to change. Even though I was in the midst of a blissful newlywed life, and we were about to welcome a baby soon, things hadn't turned out the way I envisioned. And all I feel was a sense of urgency. At this rate, I might not become a good wife or a good mother. Every day, struggling with nausea in bed and shedding tears, was truly hellish. Yet, more troubles began. Michael started coming home late, and his time at home decreased. Moreover, on the rent due date, there was no payment from Michael. We had agreed to split the rent in half when we started living together, and the rent was set up for automatic payment from my account, which I signed the lease for the apartment. But there had not been a single transfer from him. Hey, did you forget to transfer money for the rent? What's happening with it?
Just wait a bit longer. There's been a lot of drinking and entertainment this month. I'm in a bit of a financial pinch.
Every time I checked, he'd say that and put off the payment. And in the end, it was almost like I was the one paying the rent. Moreover, as payday approached, he'd increasingly ask me for loans. But I'm not able to work right now, and considering the future, I'd like to set aside our savings. Due to the morning sickness, I was practically on leave, and had reluctantly started dipping into my savings to open a nail salon. But I really wanted to keep that saved up.
The thing is, I had an unexpected business dinner at a fancy restaurant, and I'm in a pinch this month.
But shouldn't that be covered by the company's expenses?
It doesn't work that way. Plus, landing this contract now could significantly affect my promotion. Please.
He said that if he gets promoted and earns more, it would be easier to support the family. So I had no choice but to agree. But then I noticed an unfamiliar watch on Michael's wrist. Hey, where did you get that watch?
Noticed. Cool, isn't it? I've been eyeing this watch for a while.
He showed it off to me, almost like a child bragging about a treasure. That's not the point. How much did that cost?
What's it to you? I bought it with my own money. Stop nagging.
Despite me paying the full rent and even lending him money, what was he thinking? I couldn't help but snap at him. Before spending money on such things, you should have discussed it with me. You're about to become a father. When I, usually quiet, unexpectedly raised my voice, he looked surprised and then awkwardly apologized.
Sorry, I'll be better from now on, okay?
Seeing him apologize sincerely made me wonder if everything would be all right once the baby arrived, but I had a vague sense of unease. After that, the days my husband returned home became even fewer. And as the pregnancy entered the late stages, an unexpected situation arose during a prenatal checkup.
What? Hospitalization? From now?
At the checkup, they said it's a threatened preterm labor. There were still about 2 months to the due date, but the doctor advised me to be hospitalized to keep the baby in as long as possible. I was taken aback by the sudden turn of events, but determined to do my best to protect my baby. So I have mentally prepared myself for a long-term hospitalization. And there I was, on the bed, looking forward to the birth of my unborn baby. But admittedly, the days of doing nothing but rest were boring. During this time, my salvation was my best friend Sarah visiting me often. She was currently working at a detective agency specializing in infidelity investigations and would make me laugh by sharing funny and interesting stories from her work within the limits of what she could tell.
So, cheating always gets discovered, huh?
That's right. When I fell silent, Sarah looked at me intently.
Don't tell me Michael is cheating.
It's not like that, but I ended up spilling all the incidents that had been bothering me.
Leaving home that often, Michael's actions are suspicious.
Seeing Sarah mutter with a serious expression, I thought, I knew it. Deep down, I had been suspecting it, but chose to look away.
Just to make it sure, did you confirm if your marriage application was actually submitted?
What? I haven't checked it, but no way that could be. Sarah's unexpected words shocked me. I had never harbored such doubts.
Some men do that. I'm not sure about Michael, but it's better to check it.
Torn between feeling wrong to doubt my husband and wanting to clear my uneasy thoughts, I was indecisive. Then, Sarah suddenly stood up.
An administrative proxy can check it. So I'll go to the clerk's office right now to find out for you. It's better to clarify these matters.
She had me write the necessary documents for a proxy application and quickly left the room with her bag. It's okay, the marriage application must have been submitted. Just confirming that will ease my mind. Waiting as if to reassure myself, Sarah returned within an hour.
Here.
What she handed me was my family register, and there was no record of me being married to Michael. This can't be.
Then, why not ask him directly?
And so, I decided to ask him when he visited the maternity ward room the next day. When he arrived, he was smiling as usual. Despite my conflicting emotions, I knew I had to clear things up for the sake of our child. Hey, did you actually submit the marriage application?
What?
His face changed color instantly, and he fell silent, seemingly deep in thought. After a while, he began to speak.
To tell you the truth, I wanted to submit it together with you, so I decided not to go through with it.
He went to the clerk's office, but he changed his mind, thinking my condition would surely improve soon. Then you should have just told me that at the time.
I know, but after that, a lot of things happened.
He got wrapped up in some financial troubles, which also led to him being unable to make rent payments.
Feeling inadequate about becoming a father. So, I wanted to wait until this matter was settled before having a proper conversation with you.
I couldn't say anything to him as he spoke with a downcast face.
I'm sorry for making you anxious, especially with our child on the way.
At that moment, he began to cry, and I could only pat his back. I had no idea he was going through such a hard time in silence. As his wife, I need to support him. After that, my husband rarely came to visit and stopped responding to my messages. I thought maybe he was too embarrassed and needed some space, so I decided not to press the issue and just wait. Despite everything, my belly continued to grow, and the day of delivery has finally arrived. I've started having contractions in the midnight, and by morning, our daughter was born, a healthy baby weighing over 6 pounds and 9 ounces. I managed to contact Michael, and he came, but he seemed distant and wouldn't make eye contact with me. It surely bothered me, however, after enduring a challenging night and facing the proof of overcoming intense pain, I felt an overwhelming sense of happiness that made everything else fade away. Holding my small, helpless child, I was overwhelmed with emotion and tears of joy. I'm so glad you were born safely. Michael held Alice with a complicated look on his face. The day after giving birth, what was next to my pillow was a suicide note from my husband.
To Emily, you might be surprised by the sudden letter, but these are my true feelings.
The letter was filled with his agonized cries. At that time, he hadn't clearly explained, but it turned out he had fallen victim to a scam, lost all our savings, and was being chased by debt collectors. Thinking of our upcoming child and family, he saw no other way out.
If I continue to live, I'd just be a burden. That's why I intend to jump off a famous cliff known for suicides. Please forgive me. Goodbye.
His last words were shocking, leaving me, unstable after giving birth, in a daze. Rushing to the police, Michael's shoes were found at a famous cliff, presumed to have jumped into the sea, leaving me in tears. Despite a search, his body was never found. His whereabouts remained unknown, and I filed a missing person report, holding onto a sliver of hope that he would return someday. Before I knew it, 5 years had passed. During this time, all I could do was struggle through life, holding Alice. Fortunately, when I informed my parents of the birth of my daughter, they came to visit, and we reconciled. Thanks to my parents doting on my firstborn daughter Alice, I managed to get by even as a single mother. Now I'm balancing childcare and work, fighting to achieve my dream of opening my own shop. Sarah has been a great support, frequently visiting and taking me and Alice out for shopping and fun. Then an invitation from a high school buddy, Olivia Johnson, reached to me. In high school, Olivia, Sarah, and I were always together. Olivia, a CEO's daughter, had moved to Japan after high school due to her parents' business, and we had lost touch since then. She had returned to the United States before we knew it, and we were really surprised when we received an invitation to her wedding reception.
Olivia's getting married. I wonder who the lucky guy is.
Sarah called me excitedly, but I had no idea either. Maybe she met someone in Japan, or perhaps he's some corporate heir. We were both looking forward to reuniting with our friend after so long. On the day of the wedding, the venue's luxury and decoration were a testament to Olivia being a CEO's daughter. I remember Michael used to work for a company under the Johnson Group. I quietly murmured such a thing in my mind. As the lights dimmed and music played, the spotlight fell on the doors, which slowly opened. Seeing Olivia after a long time, she hasn't changed much, and her smile brightened up the surroundings like the cheerful spring sunshine making flowers bloom, reminding me of the old times. However, the moment I saw the groom standing next to her, my heart froze. What, Michael? Surprisingly, standing next to Olivia was my husband, who was supposed to have disappeared by jumping into the sea the day after Alice was born. Why is he here? And why with Olivia? I never imagined reuniting under these circumstances. Seeing him standing there in a tuxedo, smiling just like before, I was thrown into confusion. Why on earth? As I stood there, feeling like I was seeing a ghost, Sarah next to me spoke up.
Isn't that Michael?
I was thinking the same thing. That smile is just like Michael's, the slight lift of the left corner of his lip, I'm sure it's him. If even Sarah, who works at a detective agency, says so, then I was convinced at that moment it had to be my husband.
What's going on here? He was supposed to have jumped into the sea.
Yay, it's unbelievable. If that suicide note was a lie, then not entirely out of the realm of possibility. I'm filled with the desire to catch him immediately and uncover the truth, the man who disappeared, leaving behind me and our newborn daughter. Yet I decided to hold back for now, not wanting to ruin my friend's wedding. I whispered to Sarah, who seemed eager to get to the bottom of this. I have a favor to ask.
What is it? Anything?
I want to know what Michael has been doing during these missing 5 years. Can you help me? She grinned and gave me a thumbs up.
Of course, I would have investigated even if you hadn't asked me.
I'm counting on you. The very next day, we began looking into Michael. Sarah even took time off work to start tailing Michael. As we dug deeper, we stumbled upon a shocking truth. I can't believe Michael was such a person. I was hit with a wave of shock so intense, I almost crumbled.
I know it's shocking, but now that you know everything, you're not going to let this slide, are you?
Of course not. There's no way I'd let this slide. With that, we decided to take action against Michael. A few days later, we attended a party meant to introduce Michael, Olivia's husband, to everyone. We had gotten the invitations through a certain way. As I was looking for Michael somewhere in the spacious venue, I found a two in the center of a circle of people.
Emily, there he is. What do we do? He's surrounded by so many people.
Well, then we have no choice but to confront him head on.
Wait, head on, Emily, wait a sec.
Not even hearing her restraint, I took one step closer to him, clacking my heels as I went. As I came into Michael's view, his surprised expression froze. As I approached with a smile on my face, Olivia noticed me and said, Emily, thank you for coming today. You're welcome, Michael, long time no see. As I smiled at him, his face, which had been smiling until then, suddenly contorted. Michael, why are you here? Weren't you supposed to have jumped off a cliff? My loudly feigned surprise drew the attention of everyone around us. Olivia also pressed, what's going on? Michael, you know Emily.
Well, that is.
The sudden turn of events caused a stir, and Michael started to panic visibly. Olivia, you might not believe this, but listen. This man, Michael, was supposed to be my husband up until 5 years ago. As Olivia grasped Michael's chest and shook him violently, asking, what does that mean, Michael? He just looked bewildered, with his eyes rolled. There, I laid out the events of 5 years ago for everyone to hear, not hiding a thing. How he disappeared the day after I gave birth to our child, leaving behind a suicide note before jumping off a cliff. Ever since, I've been living my life to the fullest. The murmur in the room quieted down, and I could tell everyone was listening to me. But if Michael is alive and well, that means the suicide note was just for show, right? I stood in front of him and pointed. You left us because you wanted to marry Olivia. Michael, avoiding my gaze, turned pale. Whispers of "why would he go that far?" started circulating among the crowd. Olivia glared at him. "So you were dating both of us at the same time, got scared of the responsibility when I got pregnant, and ran away. You were actually planning to marry Olivia for her money."
"That's..."
Michael, pale as a ghost, desperately looked for a way out. But when Olivia's father showed up, he just sat down, cradling his head. "I went on to expose his secrets. Plus, it seems like you have debts from gambling since you were with me, amounting to over $50,000, right?" Olivia confronted him. "I never heard such a thing." And Michael started panicking.
"I was going to tell you. I swear. I had a plan to pay it all back. I was planning to tell you after I paid it all back."
"Was that plan to marry Olivia and become a CEO?" Michael fell silent at my accusation, glaring at me sharply. "5 years ago, it seems like you got drunk and were bragging to people at the bar. You were boasting about playing both sides, maybe even becoming a CEO if things worked out, and you didn't even plan to marry me." Sarah, the detective, had gathered these testimonies that I couldn't have found on my own. I thrust the investigation report right under his nose. Then he brazenly snatched the report from me and started tearing it up, as if he didn't care.
"You don't think you can get away with this scot-free. It was a mistake to get involved with you. If only you hadn't gotten pregnant."
His plan foiled. He looked like he was about to jump on me any second, with an angry demeanor. "Truly the lowest. I'll be contacting a lawyer for a divorce and child support, so be prepared. You can come out wherever you want when you try to run this time."
"You, this wasn't supposed to happen. Everything was going so well."
As he hit the floor with his fist in frustration, Olivia slowly approached him and declared, "That's my line. I can't trust you anymore. What Emily was saying is true."
"No, wait. This is all her fabrication."
Michael pleaded with Olivia, but her decision was firm. After all, Sarah and I had met with Olivia beforehand and told her the truth. That's why she had sent us the invitation for today. When Olivia shook off Michael's hand, she stood beside Sarah and me, giving Michael a cold stare.
"Come on, Olivia, think it over."
Later, Michael was sobbing, apologizing to her, but after being scolded by her father, he finally calmed down. Furthermore, Michael, who worked at Olivia's company, got the boot straight from the CEO himself and lost everything.
"It's because of you, Emily, that I couldn't become the CEO."
"Huh, this is all on you. Oh, and I forgot to mention, I'm also a CEO's daughter."
"What? You are?"
He looked utterly baffled by this sudden revelation. The truth was, my father also ran a company and planned to pass it on to me or my future husband. That's why my parents kept pushing me to get married for one reason or another, always going on about how it would look bad to others. I got estranged from my parents because I got pregnant too soon and never found the right moment to tell you. But well, it turned out for the best.
"So, if I had married you, I could have become a CEO."
Suddenly, Michael grabbed my hand and kneeled.
"Let's start over. A child needs a father, right?"
"No way. I'd never want someone like you as a father. I don't ever want to see your face again." Michael, taken aback by my outright laughter, was left speechless and in shock. Leaving him behind, Olivia, Sarah, and I left the venue together. After that, Olivia and Michael got divorced. Olivia's father was furious, vowing to claim alimony by any means necessary. I also filed for alimony and child support through a lawyer. Michael ended up with over $150,000 in debt, working tirelessly day and night, looking worn out. Meanwhile, I've been having enjoyable times having lunch with Olivia and Sarah. Furthermore, at 40, I've achieved my dream of owning my own shop. Lately, my 5-year-old Alice has started showing interest in nails, playing nail salon games with me. In those moments of my beloved daughter's endless smiles, I simply felt the joy of being alive, as a serene calmness washed over my heart.